Good morning, brother.
Morning, morning. How are you?
But the way we have changed the topic, you have changed the looks. we were all discussing about the legal issues. We are on the 22nd session today. But we just thought we should go for a session which is totally off the beat. And all the webinars pan India, we are all discussing invariably on the legal issues and primarily on the COVID. We were discussing issues which are primarily of the interest of the students as well as the young lawyers and the lawyers within the profession. So we thought it's a weekend, we should have some inputs straight from Bali's kitchen. We can have Mr. Bali, being a senior advocate, he has been representing from the petitioner side, respondent side. From whichever side is there, the other side gets a jittery, at least at the initial stage, that he has to face him. It is just like anybody coming and facing that from the other end, Vikar Yunus is coming to bowl. Let him, the nerves are already on the mind of the bowler. Same way for the other side. As large messages I had received yesterday, what do we mean by law kitchen? Because they said that it is not a topic which is being read. So ultimately, we wanted to undisclose the recipe, which ultimately Mr. Bali will be disclosing. We thought that the way to reach to one's heart is always the kitchen and the good food. And for that, you have to have a good recipe, good cutlery. Once there are the right ingredients for making food, then the food is better. As we in the home, the mother gives the secret recipe to the daughter at the time of getting married. Now, after the COVID-19, even that recipe has to be shared to the boys. For the profession, the recipe is also on the same formula. Mr. Bali has been kind enough. Everybody across the board is trying to unlock the recipe of Coke, KFC, etc. In the profession, everybody, like that day, Mr. Patwali appeared and he said that this profession is a jealous mistress. But a person who has established himself and wants to disclose the recipe, there couldn't be more fascinating thing for the students in the law, young lawyers and lawyers like us, that at least we can know some recipes and the ingredients. They again say that all recipes are still not disclosed, but we believe that Mr. Bali will at least share the recipe so that the bar becomes more stronger. He will also disclose us what are the cutleries, what are the crockeries which are required to not only the food to be sumptuous, the art of presentation. Because presenting on a good platter, the platter would look better if it is on good plates, good crockery. So drafting is just like akin to a kitchen, and presentation is the crockery. And judges ultimately cherish once it comes from the person like Mr. Bali. Over to you, Mr. Bali.
Thank you so much, Vikasji. I first of all welcome everybody who is a participant in this webinar. It is indeed a pleasure to talk on a topic which is very close to my heart, because when I go to the court and my entire journey as a lawyer, and even now I feel that there is so much more to learn even today for myself, for me. And I feel that the youngsters who are wanting to take up this profession, maybe they are in schools right now or they are still in law colleges. They are still lawyers who still have to start working, or they have started working somewhere. This is a very big spectrum, this profession, how to get into it. If you got into it, what to do about it. Once you understand a little bit, you then feel, oh my God, I am so far away from success. So yes, this is a very important topic, and we have had some very outstanding lawyers who have come on this platform, who have spoken on different subjects or different variety of laws, and I've also spoken in one of them. And yes, to take a leaf from Mr. Vikas's book, he says that you've come now for the second time and your look has changed. I thought there must be a novelty in what you do. So not only the speaker's look should change, the topic should also change. Now, I'm really grateful to Vikas that he's brought up this topic, and something which is for the youngsters. And not only the youngsters who are doing law or have gone into the profession, even for those people who are about 5, 7, 10, 15 years into the profession, who must be asking themselves questions as to what is the ultimate situation I should create for myself that I should be successful. Now, in this entire talk, I was thinking about this webinar for quite some time when Vikasji told me that we have to start a discussion on this. And I deliberately thought that I'm going to make this talk very simple in a layman's language. I'm not going to use authors of law or big illuminaries of law and bring out what they have said about the profession. I feel that is there, that bookish knowledge is there for everybody to read. I'm going to talk about a practical aspect of our profession vis-a-vis our courts and our system. So therefore, I want it to be very simple in a layman's language so that everybody understands something which comes out from my heart. Now, I will start from the basics. You see, we all belong to different strata of the society. We, all of us, do not live in cities. We have a different social educational background. Some of us are first generation lawyers. So they have not seen what actually their fathers practicing or their brothers practicing. And they have not, you know, if there's a lawyer in somebody's home and you see a lot of law practices, they are from home. The offices are at home. So a child while growing up, if he's a second generation lawyer, he is passively learning so many things which are a day-to-day functionality of a lawyer, but maybe a first-generation lawyer would not have that background with him. Then it also is also very important that what kind of educational background you have been exposed to. There will be some people who will be in the cities who will be going to very good convent schools, schools which make you a master in a particular language, that is English. And English is fortunately or unfortunately a language which is a court language. All journals, etc., are written in English. Your drafting to higher courts and supreme courts are also in that language. But there will be some people who will be right from the villages who will not have that kind of an education or an education on language. Mostly now the law schools, they start operating after you finish your 12th. Now when you are in your 12th, there are a lot of candidates, a lot of people who want to be lawyers. They would take up law, maybe not out of passion of law, because they have not been able to hone their skills in chemistry, biology, mathematics, and therefore there are a lot of options which are closed for them. So they say, yes, profession, getting to be a lawyer is one of the things I must take up to. Maybe this is a good profession, but maybe that passion or that thought process that I want to be a big lawyer one day, or I want to be a lawyer and this was always my calling, was not there. It is because of various circumstances you take up a call to go into a law university. Now let's talk about law universities. Now there will be a variety of law universities. There will be people from various strata of society who will be in a law university. There will be top law schools, top law schools where admission is very difficult to get through an entrance examination. But there will also be law college and schools which are not very celebrated, but which would cater to the education of law and would ultimately give you a degree and ultimately you will get a license to practice law. Now, what happens during that period of 5 years? This is something which has really bothered me about the education system as far as the legal profession is concerned. You see, I will give you examples. If you want to be a doctor, you join an MBBS course. Ultimately, during the course of your practicals, you are taught how to dissect, how to operate on a frog, then on a dead body, and all practical things which you are going to do as a doctor are shown to you in a laboratory or in a platform of your practical examinations and practicals which take place. Similarly, people who do their MBA, they are during the course of their education told about a lot of practical facets of economics. Unfortunately, in our legal system, and I say that about even the top law schools, the education fundamental is good. There'll be universities who will have various kind of education fundamentals which will be very strong and very good. But now the aspect of profession which a lot of law colleges and universities do not look at is that a lawyer does not only need to know the law on the bookish knowledge, he also needs to run a practice. So by the time a 2B lawyer is about 3 years into his education, I think all the law universities, colleges, etc., should ask the student, as to what kind of law he wants to practice. Does he want to go on the corporate side? Does he want to go on the litigation side? And then the practical aspect should start where even how to dress up presently, how you should be presentably dressed up, what should be your demeanor when you walk into a court? Is your oratory good enough if you want to be a lawyer going to the court? How do you deal with clients? How do you procure work? I think this all should be made an aspect of education while granting a degree of law, which unfortunately does not happen. So what do you do? What do you do when you are a student and you are wanting to be a successful lawyer? I think the best thing is that during the course of your education, let's say in about third or fourth year, you join a good law office where you see the practical side of the profession whenever you're during vacations, etc. And if you can manage, start drafting small-time applications, petitions, etc. By the time you finish your law, you would have seen some practical side. I'm not talking about you working as interns and going with the concept that we are going to be, you know, lawyers one day. So that seriousness sometimes is not there. Now, ultimately, you get a law degree and you say, oh, I've got my license. Now I'm going to start. So I feel for a starter as a lawyer, the most important thing is how to draft a petition, how to draft a case, how to draft an application. Once a lawyer is good in that, he becomes indispensable in any office. Now, once you start that journey, you start drafting cases, you start educating yourself, then comes the biggest challenge, going to court. Now, there are lawyers who would want to do trial work because maybe they are living in the districts, they don't have access to high courts, or they do not want to shift themselves to a city where they would like to go to a high court. There'll be lawyers in the city who will have original jurisdiction in their high court, like Chandigarh High Court does not have original civil jurisdiction, but there will be Delhi High Court, etc., will have civil, the original civil jurisdiction. So, what is trial work? How do you lead evidence? How do you cross-examine? There are all facets which you learn while you get into the profession. Now, the question is, how do I learn? I've just got to be a lawyer, and this case which has come to me. And I have this only case, and now I have to procure this client. This client should not go away anywhere. What should I do? So when you start out, you earmark certain lawyers which you follow in the High Court or in the Supreme Court, wherever you are. You feel that some lawyer has done very well for himself. You start following him. You see how he reacts when a judge asks him a question. What kind of reaction the judge is having when he's answering a question, a question to the judge. So all these facets make a wholesome bouquet for you to become a good lawyer. Now comes the very important question which a young lawyer always asks himself. He says, look here, I've got totally prepared for a case. I have read for weeks. I've prepared for weeks and this is the case I had, and I go to the court and I stand up and within 3 minutes, the judge totally demolishes me, throws my file away. I don't have an opportunity to speak. I can't speak. But look at the other person who's a senior counsel who's appeared in the court. The court is indulging him. He's asking him questions. So what is wrong with me? The answer is very simple. Do not get demoralized. Do not get demoralized at all. This is a transition phase in your life. Whenever you join the profession, always remember that the first 7 years are the hard miles. In the first 7 years, you'll be putting in 100% of effort or maybe 150% of effort to get maybe 10% gain. Your fee structure will be very, very low. Your fee structure. Prepared so hard, but does not give you proper audience. You would sometimes feel that yes, I've gone to the court and I did not get my due. But do not give up hope. In this profession, the basic fundamental is that you work hard and you perform the best under the circumstances. You perform for your own self. You perform to do your best in the case. Your job is to just go to the court and try to do the best you can and let everything else follow. If you lose a case, yes, you get demoralized. If you do not get the order you want that day, you get demoralized. But you should not get demoralized as long as you think that you've done your best. And I've always said that this profession is like a beauty pageant. I've said this in so many talks I've done earlier also, that you, there's a Miss Universe crown. So there's a girl who's very beautiful. It's not that she's good, very beautiful, so she's going to get the crown. It also depends how she walks, how she comes up to the judges, what kind of questions she answers, how she answers it. So as a lawyer, it's a whole wide conspectus which you have to follow. It is not your education. It is not your preparation in a brief. It is not, are you abreast with law? There is another, there are two more dimensions to it. The second dimension is that when you go to the court, how do you conduct yourself in the court? Are you presentable? Does your speech offend anybody? Is your speech pleasant, but is your speech also assertive? You see, a lot of lawyers feel that this is a profession where I have to speak and I have to have the best oratory. Also remember that more important than that is a fact that a lawyer, a good lawyer, should be able to listen well. So when a judge is asking you a question, you will find a lot of lawyers, even before the judge has completed his question, they start answering in between. So at that time, I feel that you immediately make the judge your adversary. Always involve, listen, think, answer. What to say, how to say, when to say is very important. The other thing which I feel a young budding lawyer should do, you must be aware about the present circumstances which are happening. The latest general knowledge about day-to-day things. You see how the events of the day or events of the month also weigh upon the mind of the honorable judges. They are also human. They don't come from a factory. Every judge is different. Every judge's fabric is different. There are judges who are very patient. There are judges who are totally impatient. There are judges who read the files when they come from home and they will ask you a pointed question. There will be judges who will not read the file and they will let you say what you want to say. But a general awareness about your surroundings, about things which are happening, always give you an edge. Because sometimes in the court of law, when you are making your submissions, you are going, the discussion goes beyond the brief. And at that time, if the judge thinks that you come across as a lawyer who is otherwise knowledgeable, it helps you a lot. Also, remember that a lawyer has to try and put across his point to the honorable judge, and do not lose heart if you are being interjected, if the honorable judge is asking you questions, or you have not been able to start the way you wanted to start. Always remember that this is going to be a different formula every time. It is going to be a different platform every time. Every judge is different. And therefore, so many times you must have seen that in the evening when you get the list, the cause list, as to where my case is going to be listed the next day. Your concept about the case and how it is going to be changes. Sometimes you must try to push your case across, but never cross the line. A good lawyer must understand the difference between assertive, aggressive submission and crossing the line. And I would say, out of my past experience, that how so aggressive you are in the court and how so assertive you are in the court, as long as you do not cross the line of decency, as long as you do not offend the judge, the honorable judge does not mind a lawyer who argues his case passionately. There'll be some honorable judges who will tell you to tone down. Do that. Do that. There will be some honorable judges who will not, to them it will make no difference at all. So, you have to play the day. You have to you all must have followed cricket one time or the other, or there must be people passionate about it. You see when both the captains go to the wicket and they say we are going to toss, who's going to bat first, who's going to bowl first. So what do? They look at the wicket, they look at the conditions, then they decide how to bowl, how to bat, when to bowl, when to bat. Same way. Being a good lawyer is way beyond that. Now, I'll give you some example, which is a food for thought for all of you. You see, we have clients of various strata coming to us. We have clients with very high education. We have clients who are IAS officers, IPS officers, MBAs, people who are running companies, people who are very well educated. Now, you must ask yourself a question always. Why does this person need a lawyer? He's so educated. He speaks so well. Why can't he do his own case in the court? You're allowed to do that. Why does he need a lawyer? That is where you must get the answer. That I have to be a medium between him and the judge, and to put his point across in such a manner that it ultimately helps him out. And my advice to all lawyers who are wanting to go to court to argue matters is, do not advance your arguments in a manner where you make the honorable judge your opposing counsel. Get into a conversation, a healthy conversation about the facts of your case, about the law. And I must tell you one thing, master your facts, master your brief, your file, you should know every page. If you do not know everything about the law, it does not make a difference. But every page of your brief and the concerned statute which concerns your case, if there is any, you should know about it. Rest you will know with experience. With more cases, the more you argue or the more you prepare, you know what to do at what time. This will all come with experience. But this is the basic thing, that you as a lawyer should be a master of your file. Read it thoroughly. You don't understand it, read it again. Yes, there will be people who will understand something in 10 minutes. There will be people who will understand something in 1 hour. But ultimate situation will be that you have to be totally prepared as far as the facts of the case are concerned. Now, there is also a very important aspect of law, which is clients. So these you youngsters who are coming into the profession, people who have been in the profession for some time, they say, where are the clients? How come Mr. X has so many clients and I don't? So therefore, you have to make yourself versatile. You have to get into the system where you get to know people, you get to know people who are coming to the court, and the best way to get clientage is to win the confidence of your seniors. Because your seniors, even if you're not working in their office, when they see you perform and there is a matter which comes to them, which they don't want to take up, they will always remember that this young boy, I saw him arguing very well, or he had prepared a case very well. Why don't you go to him? So your best procurement comes from your seniors. You always must remember that win the confidence of the client within your ethical realms. If you have worked hard in your case and you have done your best, you may lose the case, you will never lose the client. And lastly, before I end my talk and then I'll take the questions, because I thought that I want this to be a very interactive session. I want more questions to come in. So whatever my experience talks about as a lawyer, I'll share it with the youngsters when they ask me questions. There's another aspect of law which I want to talk about are the ladies and the women who get into law. And I'm being very honest about it. For them, it is a very difficult profession to take up. I'm not talking about metro cities and I'm talking about cities. And I must tell all my young woman lawyers who are watching this discussion, please do not lose heart. Yes, people feel that a woman is going to get married, how she probably will have no interest in my case. You might have this kind of a situation when you join some senior's office. I tell you, and I must give you a head start, that I have found all the lady interns who have come to my office to be very hardworking, to be very brilliant, to be more focused. And you can also build up a practice. The times have changed. Competent lawyer is the need of the hour. And my personal experience is that there are so many other aspects of law, corporate law, going to a good law firm, and going into the judiciary. Maybe it's the superior courts or it is the high court. And I have found that the honorable lady judges sometimes have less egos, are more receptive. So this profession is beaming, and this profession is very good for all my lady lawyers who are listening to this. You must have that just to go ahead. You can achieve big heights in this profession. And that's what I wanted to say, Vikasji.
Thank you. Anybody who wants to pose the question, it can be. But till the questions come, two questions have come. After your peppy talk, three things which forthcome. That law, according to you, would be just like a traffic light. That when you go to the court, a red light, yellow light, and the green light. First, prepare it, then be ready with the facts, and then just put it forth across to the bench. And then the second, what you had posed, I also concur with that, what you say. You can lose the case, but don't lose the judge while making your submissions. And thirdly, what you told, that when you join any chambers, or for the fact, let's assume somebody is not into Mr. Bali's office, or for that matter, any senior counsel, he might not teach you. So you also have to become like an Eklavya and learn from the Dronacharya by observing him. Because observing and absorbing are the two facets of the profession which help you to improve better. And Mr. Bali, being the secretary of the PCA, that is why he pitched in that the pitch is an important factor, while correlating it with the court as to how it will be an important factor. The questions have come. Rangat Gira says a new lawyer mostly joins a senior in the beginning. What should be his main takeaway points from for him, for his seniors, and how to know when to go independent?
You see, you must understand a comfort level when you join an office. My take on this will be, do not join an office of a super senior. Join an office where you will actually be needed. You see, I'll give you an example. When you join a very big law office, that law office already has a lot of associates who are working. They are already doing a little bit of tasks which are already given to them. So you are sometimes not needed that much in that office. Suppose you go totally raw and you have no knowledge of any drafting, pleading, etc., etc. Yes, that office will work for you. But I would ideally want a youngster who joins the profession to join an office of an upcoming senior who cannot afford to have more than three or four associates, so that you will get more exposure there. You'll get chance to draft matters, you'll get chance to prepare matters. You will then be the first call of that senior. And as far as when to go independent, you see, nowadays concepts have changed. You might go to a senior who takes all the law associates together and creates a big office for practice, where independently lawyers can practice and they practice for his office also. It is your call. Going independent is absolutely your call, which you have to take, that am I ready to do everything on my own, I want to do it on my own. And if I am ready to do that, whether it is after 6 months of joining the senior, whether it is after 5 years of joining the senior, whenever that process, that thought process comes to your mind, that now I want to do it on my own, I think that is the time to take the decision.
Thank you.
Vikasji, can I make a request that any speaker who comes, if I can get a little bit of his background, it will be easy for me to answer the question, like which high court is he from and where is he practicing?
That person in the participant participation, who is doing the participation, he can post it in the chat box. Though we invariably don't do the unmuting, but since the session is more of the interactive session rather than the normal format which you follow, they can post it on the chat box that they want to get themselves unmuted. They can also address themselves while asking the question. That is why in the normal format of this sessions, we generally keep 50 minutes talk. And here we had kept it 30 minutes, the pep talk, T20 type play.
Yes. Bimaldeep
Singh, he's probably from the GNDU. He asks, what is your take? Can there be a law as a subject as a stream in 10+2? And what should the Bar Council do to facilitate the legal education to be more made more attractive?
I must tell you that there are schools, I know of a few in Chandigarh, who have started some kind of a legal education or legal subjects in class 11th and 12th. Though there are not many who are doing it, but it will not be a bad idea to do so. Now, as far as the Bar Council's role is concerned, I think they can play a very dynamic role. But it is also for the people who are making courses for the educationists, who are making courses for law degrees. They must understand the fabric of our judicial system. The unfortunate part is that they do not understand the practical aspect of our legal system. There are so many facets to it. It is not that every lawyer who's going to finish his law is going to land up in the Supreme Court or is going to land up in the high courts. So therefore, they should understand that our judicial system starts from a civil judge, then goes to a district judge or a sessions court, then goes to the high court. Those areas needs to be covered. And therefore, that practical bookish knowledge, preparing documents, papers, because a lawyer always is going to have books and statutes in his hand to prepare documents. So therefore, that aspect of education definitely needs to be looked at. And I'm the Bar Council is a very competent authority. I'm sure they'll be working on it.
Mr. Bali, a few questions on my WhatsApp I've received as well as in the private chat.
Yes.
They are asking that your main focus right now was on the profession. What is your take as to whether they should join the corporate, whether they should join some firm, whether they should take a government job, or whether they should opt for the lower judiciary? Because being a young lawyer and who is good at academics, invariably wants to also latch upon the subordinate judiciary.
You see, I'll go step by step. Whether you want to go into the corporate field or you want to go into orthodox litigation should be decided by you at least in the fourth year of your education process. Both are poles apart. But even when you do corporate law, you will need knowledge of how the court functions, because ultimately and everything is going to end up in the court. Now, as far as corporate law is concerned, there are a lot of facets which are now opened up, amalgamations, agreements, paperwork. So if you feel that you are more comfortable in research work, it is more comfortable for you to sit on a desk and prepare something, and you would feel, you see, when you join a good law firm, you get a particular pay package. When you join the profession, some of the young lawyers for the first 6, 7, 8 months do not earn anything at all. It will also depend upon your financial situation, your financial status. But try to take that option about within the fourth year of your education system. And then I always say so, you will always find people, you will always find lawyers, even in the corporate law firm, which are very, very open to a young student coming to them to learn the practical processes of whether corporate law or orthodox litigation. You must try to make an endeavor to yourself take practical experience of these facets. Yes, because you have answered the question.
Jaspreet Singh asked, what is the best way to attract to the clients being a young lawyer? How do you make the mark? Because you are not allowed the advertisement, etc. by the Bar Council.
Sorry, come again. Vikasji, I lost your...
The question is that in Bar Council, we are not allowed to advertise. So what is the best way to mark your name in the institution that you are a good lawyer, you are an alternative?
You see, your best advertising is word of mouth. When I was giving my talk, I told you that a lawyer who goes to orthodox practice or he goes to corporate practice, he becomes indispensable if he can draft well. If he can prepare cases, applications, agreements, etc., etc. Secondly, whenever you go to brief a lawyer, brief a senior when he's exposed to your talent, would always recommend you for further work. If your client knows that you have done your job well and you get some kind of success in your case, that very client will be your biggest advertisement. So ultimately, it all boils down to how well you perform. Yes, you're not allowed to advertise as far as the Bar Council rules are concerned. But your advertisement is so fast. If you perform well, and if you prepare your case well, you will be advertised by your senior, people who will see you, and also your client.
Taking cue from Mr. Bali, he is intending to say that coins make more noise, currency doesn't, but it has more value.
Yes.
Bimaldeep saying, again from GNDU, ask, can there be a uniform slave-eye and entrance rather than blue-eyed, grey-eyed, black complexion law schools? And how is your take the manner in which Mr. K.K. Venugopal, Mr. Justice Rajiv Bhalla, they have allowed their digital platforms to be used by ordinary persons? Their libraries they've allowed it to be used by anybody.
Well, that is an individual situation where somebody allows some people to take benefit of whatever they have. I mean, they are people who have achieved a lot in law. It's time for them to give back, and it is a time for all of us to give back in whatever manner and way we can give. Now, as far as these uniform syllabus is concerned, you see, there is a fabric every university follows. They feel that a particular system of education will be better equipped for a person who takes up law. It is for you to understand that this is the kind of education I want to get for myself when I'm studying the various aspects of law, going to get a degree. So I think the uniform syllabus will be something which will impede upon the basic fundamental right of an educational institute to teach in the manner they want to. Yes, Vikasji.
Deepak Verma, he's from our High Court itself. He says how a lawyer should remain fit, energetic, attentive, even while changing the strategies from one case to another, while jostling from one court to another, and what should be the routine for being more successful?
You see, this is a very good question you asked me. I've always felt that a healthy body is a prime ingredient for a healthy mind. So whenever you are in the profession, you don't burn out yourself just by reading and thinking that, oh, what am I going to do? My case is going to be there. Involve yourself in some extracurricular activities, especially sporting activity, fitness. You know, it will take your stress out. Follow something which is your passion other than law. It will always help you. And this is not only about our profession, any other profession you do. And it will also make you fitter, response well. So I've seen a lot of youngsters who are working very hard, but you know, they're not looking after their health, or they're not looking after their physical well-being. This is one aspect you must look at. You must give yourself about an hour's time every day where you should spend time on yourself. You should do some good physical activity to be, you know, sparklingly fit. Because if you're fit, you're physically doing well, then mentally you will have an edge over everybody else who's your contemporary in the profession, always. I'll just give an example. Suppose in our code, you have to run from code number 69 to code number 8. And there are two matters left. So if you're faster physically than the other lawyer, you might reach it and the other lawyer might miss his case.
So according to you, the difference is between the two vowels only. Either you can be fit or you can be fat.
No, you can, change, isn't it? You can be thin and you can still be unfit.
Then it more also depends upon the mental state of health. Now, one yes. person is asking how to deal with the lawyers whose image is such that he, if he's an opposite counsel, what is the best way to tackle him? He wants the Krishan Sutra to be disclosed today.
You see, it is all momentarily. When you come to the court, you make your submission, you do not know what the other side is going to say or what he's going to do. And like Vikasji, when he started giving the presentation, he talked about there are some batsmen who fear Waqar Yunus coming to them bowling at 150 miles. But you also must remember that Waqar Yunus also bowled to Sachin Tendulkar. So you have to have faith in yourself. How so big the other lawyer is, you have to make sure that you do your presentation, you do your bit. And I must tell you that if a lawyer who's young, who's prepared well, who argues and makes a good point in the court, I will tell you that 75% of the honorable judges would lean towards him and not towards the senior if the balance is 50-50. I have experienced it myself, and I'll tell you something very interesting out of my experience. I was about 4 or 5 years old in the profession, and I was pitted in the court against Mr. Rohinton Nariman. I had lost the case from the High Court. I thought I had a very good case. And I started my submission, and I knew that if I would say about 2 or 3 points, my case was indefensible. I would win the case. So the moment I would try to make out my submission, Mr. Nariman would get up and interject. It was probably, you know, his style of advocacy, very aggressive, very flamboyant, outstanding lawyer, now an outstanding Supreme Court judge. So you see, after second time when he interjected me, I got up and very innocently told the court that, look here, I am writing, fighting for the rights of my client. And my freedom of speech is being curtailed, which is my right as a lawyer to speak. Forget about Article 21. So the honorable judges, they looked at each other and they said to Mr. Nariman, please sit down and don't say anything till the time the young counsel finishes his submission. They did not know my name because I was very young in the profession. So during the course of submission, the big lawyer again got up and the honorable court said, now young counsel, you sit down, we will argue the case for you. So I knew I had won the case that day. What else did I need to do when the judges were ready to argue a case for me? So therefore, what I'm trying to tell you, I mean, such a big name as Mr. Rohinton Nariman, as that time he was in the profession. And the honorable judges thought that this young counsel is not getting a chance to speak, though he's very well prepared. So let us help him out. And you know what happened? And this is what I'll tell you about the great grace and this great institution. So I was very young. I was about 4 or 5 years in the profession. I won a case, and for me, it was a very big thing. I came out and I had Mr. Nariman standing outside the court. He patted my back and he said, well done, young fellow. So always remember, a good senior who opposes you will be a senior who will seek spark in you, and inside he must be wanting to win it for this client. But a good senior who wants this institution to grow would actually want you to be successful.
Thank you. I would not be taking separately names because invariably large number of people asked, what is your take whether you should start initial practice in the district court or the direct to the high court or the Supreme Court if one intends to practice?
This is a question which comes across to me time and time again. You see, we do not have original civil jurisdiction in our court. So I am talking about Punjab and Haryana High Court right now. I feel practicing in the district courts and the high courts are totally two different things altogether. Yes, every kind of work you have done ever in your life, whether it is in the district court or in a civil court or anywhere, would help you ultimately when you are in the high court. But I do not believe in this theory that if you want to be successful in the high court, it's a must that you must have practiced in the district court. Because in original civil jurisdiction, and when you come to see what is the high court, is Article 26 to 27, 482 petitions, writs, and also appeals. And in all of that, what you are doing is you are already reading the record and arguing in the court. And I always feel that a lawyer who has to permanently think that he is going to come into the high court, if he spends a lot of time in the districts, his mindset never becomes that of a high court lawyer. According to me, if you want to practice in the high court, it is not a must that you must have practiced in the district courts and therefore you will be a successful lawyer. Yes, if you ever want to know what actually happened in the district courts, you can visit it once a while. You can always focus your practice in the high court and you can always learn while being in the high
court. Shrisha Jain is being posed in the question, but he writes himself as Aditya Soni and he says he's working in your office in Delhi. And he wants to pose the question directly. He says it's a first time other way around that instead of drafting himself and showing it to you, he can get the draft from you and get it approved, whether it is as per his choice or not.
Sorry, I did not get
the question. He wants to pose the question directly. I am saying it's other way around. Invariably, the associate working with the senior, he drafts it and gets his approval from the senior. Now, he will ask a question and he will approve it, whether it is according to his satisfaction or not. Over to you, Soni.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, my question is, I'm good, sir. Sir, my question is something that we've learned from you, and I think everybody listening to this cast can benefit from. Sir, how does a young advocate strike a balance between following the instructions given to him by his senior and using his own mind? Because one drawback that a lot of young advocates have is that they don't have the patience to listen to a senior's instructions and following them from point A to point B and sailing it through. So it is something that we've learned from you. And if this whole cast can listen to the same thing from you, I think they'll really benefit from the same.
You see, in this profession, something which is really wanting in a lot of us is patience. Patience as a young lawyer, even patience at my stage. I feel you have to be patient to even be successful in this profession. The moment you come into the profession, you are looking at the big stalwarts. They are coming in very expensive cars. They have expensive homes. They've all earned it. It's been the time they've spent in the profession to make it to that level. Now, as far as the patience to hear a senior is concerned, you know, when I started my talk, I said that if you want to be a good lawyer, you must listen well, whether it's the court or whether it's your senior. If you get into the habit of listening well, you'll always perform better. Now, as far as following your instructions of your senior to the T, you see, Aditya, you'll be sometimes faced with a very difficult situation that the senior has instructed you to do one or two, three things. Suppose he's told you to take a pass over or to take an adjournment in the matter. And he's told you strictly do not argue the matter. But the bench insists that, Mr. Soni, I don't care, I'm not passing over, I am not adjourning the matter, you argue. So even then, when your senior has instructed you not to argue, you'll have no other choice, you'll have to argue. But then make out a case for your senior to say that, look here, sir, despite your instructions were there not to argue the case and I requested the bench that I cannot argue, take this opportunity, argue, perform well and tell your senior, look here what I've done.
Thank you, sir.
Ayush Goyal, you can mute yourself. Ayush Goyal wants to ask, what would be the manner to improve the drafting?
Oh, you see, it's a very, very pertinent question, very important. See, if you are drafting something, first basic fundamental is do it in a chronological manner. start from the oldest date to the latest date. Your chronology of events should not break. And if you can, when you do your synopsis, in one paragraph at the top, just crystallize the case into a pressy writing so that an honorable judge has the benefit. Suppose it's a 50-page paper book or a 40-page paper book or a 200-page paper book. The honorable judge, when he sees the first paragraph, he immediately understands what the case is. The most important aspect, other than that, is please ensure that while drafting a case, you do not miss a point which is important. You deliberately do not take out a document which is supposed to be there in the file. While drafting and presenting the case before the court, when the court finds you short of giving information to the court which is otherwise required to be given, that part of drafting would not only make you lose the case, it will make you lose the judge forever. So therefore, drafting of a matter, preparation of a case is a very huge responsibility. And therefore, we seniors, the moment we get designated, we run away from it. Because we do not want to take the pain of drafting anymore. And therefore, the basic fundamental, the basic basement, ground floor, the whole structure of the success of your profession is outstanding drafting. So I would always say, don't miss the chronology, don't miss the documents, don't miss the events. And if you're talking about law, see, you may be a beginner, you may not know how to prepare your grounds that well. Go to a Supreme Court judgment, which is in your favor. Look at the language used by the honorable judges in that judgment. Pick up that language, put it in your grounds. And ultimately, you will have a habit of writing the same way in your grounds, the way the judgments are written. So that is one thing you can always pick up from judgments when you're writing your grounds.
I've answered your question. Siddharth Shekhar says, I would like to ask, when you deal some big matters, and there's a media trial also going, and does it affect the mindset of a judge and the lawyer, and how to get over that thing?
Very important. It's a very, very valid question. See, ultimately what happens is that the honorable judges are also human beings. Every honorable judge today, I do not believe, would not be going through a newspaper or through, looking at television channels on an important matter. I feel somewhere or the other, it does definitely make a difference. But an outstanding judge would be the one who would go by the law. Your job as a lawyer is to do only one thing. Prepare your case on facts and in law, do your best, and if a matter which relates to being exposed in the media, whatever reaction an honorable judge makes out of it, which you feel is, you will know that it is based upon a media report, it's not based upon your matter, then you must try to convince the court that, look here, in law, my case is strong. Media, it's doing its own job. I'm doing my job. And ultimately, within the four corners of law, I have a case to make out. So you can please ignore whatever the media said and give me relief.
Mr. Subhash Saini, he has retired after the government job. He says, what is advisable? After the retirement, it is advisable to practice in the trial court or the higher court?
What rank did you retire on, sir?
He's a superintending engineer from Chandigarh itself. Fortuitously, I know him otherwise.
So if you want to practice law after the kind of office you have already held, I would always suggest that you should practice in the high court. You will feel more comfortable there. In the district court, it's not that I'm saying that a lawyer is uncomfortable. It's a huge effort to, record evidence, to run from one court to the other, to try and understand the nitty-gritties of, evidence and applications, etc. In the high court, it is more regimented. And it is more on the stage of where you either prepare a writ petition or you prepare an appeal where documents are already with you. I think with your knowledge in your field, the way you must have worked and so many years you put into service, I think High Court will be an ideal place for you to practice.
Nikunj Dhawan is from, again, from the High Court itself. He asked, during these COVID situations, the litigation is reduced. And what should be the strategy? How should one think to operate during these lockdowns? What should be the best way to open new vistas for him during these times?
You see, one should take you from Mr. Vikas Chatra's platform where he's created this fantastic webinar where so many people are online and talking to each other. I think the court should follow some model like this for hearing cases out. There cannot be any situation which would bring an institution to a standstill. Work must go on. We have technology at our hands. We must start, and we must immediately start doing matters by video conferencing. A lawyer should be allowed to set up his entire kind of a studio or a kind of a place from his office where he can get a link to the bench. The bench can also be there through means of Wi-Fi. And I think it is a time that we must look very seriously into it. And even beyond COVID, see, people coming from far off places, far flung places, I think video conferencing and video the courts through video conferencing should become a norm. People from far-flung places should not be, coming and congesting the courts. There should be one dedicated time and day where the courts should function through video conferencing.
Mr. Bali, the questions are pouring in. As usual, you are flooded with balls from all sides coming. Tushar Kaushik has posed one question, but that is on contract. Tushar, you can stay connected with us. We are having one session on labor laws on COVID. That ELP has agreed with tie up with us. They will advise us on this issue. So I'm not posing a question to Mr. Bali because the platform right now is this. So one of the domain, while after hearing Mr. Bali, is that the once you are making a submission, sirf us din Arjun ko us din ki aankhi dikhni chahiye aur kuch nahi dikhna chahiye. Sir Palak Nagar from CAM says, my question is, how should a lawyer mold his career if becoming a senior advocate is the goal? What does it take from one being designated as a senior?
You see, arguing in court and making out a case is basically what ultimately is a journey where you reach to get designated. So it's a journey which starts from where you are exposed to the court, where you start drafting very well, you start preparing your cases very well, you argue cases to the satisfaction of the court and to the satisfaction of your clients. But you should not, right from the beginning, or maybe 7-8 down years down the profession, start thinking, oh, I have to become a senior. Let it happen at its own pace. Yes, do aim for it. But if you have it right from the beginning of your profession that you want to become a senior, you will maybe lose your track somewhere. You always remember one thing: good drafting, good speech in court. I said good presentation. It is not that you have to look fashionable in court. You have to look presentable in court. You have to have a smile. You have to have good oratory. You must keep on honing your skills of journal knowledge, your language, and ultimately you will find that your presence in court starts making a difference. The moment as a counsel your presence in court starts making a difference, whether it's the drafting of your case or whether the way you speak in the court, you are absolutely ready to don the medal to be designated as a senior advocate.
Mr. Bali, we are 12:29. We will not be taking any question. The only one aspect, while somehow we are just one year difference in the batch. And with the flux of time, I have noticed that despite being very successful professional, you have maintained the balance between the family and the profession. What is the key? Because there are pressing circumstances within the family sometimes and within the profession also. How do you one maintain the family? Because that day I was talking to your children, they said, actually our family is true family because family means father and mother, I love you. And we love our parents. So what is your take and how do you maintain the balance?
Vikas, you see, it's about time management. every lawyer must learn how to manage his time well. And I feel if you want to manage your time well, you have to do one thing. You have to honor the timelines you have given to yourself. Suppose you have to give a meeting at 5:30, you should be there at 5:25. You have to be caught in at 10 o'clock, you should be there at 9:45. So I have managed all these things because I have been able to be very disciplined in following my timelines. And I've always done one thing, it's a personal choice which I've done, that whenever I've walked out of the court or of my office, the moment I come out of the door of my office, I do not discuss law, I do not get into any legal discussion. Even the friends which I socialize are not necessarily lawyers, they are friends from various facets of life. And then something which is personal to me, when I go for conventions or seminars, I'm very careful in choosing, because I feel that a lot of them are basically meant for social networking, and it is not basically to take out the best of law. So therefore, I have to just tell you that give yourself time and just bracket your time in a proper manner. You will always find that there will be enough time for you. And you can fit in so many things. And family is very important. Though it looks that I give a lot of time to my family, but sometimes I may not be able to do that. But yes, with the advent of time, as you grow in the profession, do take out some designated days, day in the week, or some time where you spend the time for yourself and for your family. And I must tell you one thing, as far as my personal experience is concerned, please take out me time for you. Me time means time exclusively for yourself. As a professional, to de-stress and to understand where have you gone wrong and where you have progressed, you must spend in 1 week at least 20 minutes just by yourself, give it to yourself and understand what you are doing. That is a very important aspect.
Thank you, Mr. Bali. The points have been... Hello. Amit Prasher, you have been in this office. Till Mr. Bali comes back, we would like to know what are your experiences in his office. How do you find yourself?
Sorry, Vikasji.
Meanwhile, I had asked Amit to share his experience because he's from your office. Just a minute from Amit and then back to you.
I'll only say one line, that motivation is for amateurs and discipline is for professionals. So whatever sir is saying today is to motivate us, the amateurs like us. And for him, as he said, it is for only the discipline being the 100% professional. So I have never met such a professional guy in my whole career up till now, that we follow the footsteps of Mr. Bali. That's what I want to say.
Amit, ek jaate jaate share ho jaye.
Abhi nahi, baad mein.
Nahi, abhi ho jaye.
Nahi, 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 baad mein.
Dedicated to you, sir.
Nahi, nahi,
dedicated to you, sir.
No, dedicated to Mr. Bali.
Yeah.
Dedicated to Mr. Bali.
Yeah.
Kuch likhne baithu, to loves bhi tere. Kuch likhne baithu, to loves bhi tere. Kuch bolu, to lehza bhi tera aur andaaz bhi tere. So, लिखने बैठूं तो ड्राफ्टिंग हम करते हैं तो सोचते हैं हम सर की तरह ही ड्राफ्टिंग कर रहे हैं और कुछ बोलते हैं कोर्ट में तो हम लहजा भी वही होता है अंदाज भी वही होता है हम सोचते हैं कि मिस्टर बाली आर्ग्यू कर रहे हैं दो वी ट्राई आर बेस्ट टू कॉपी हिम बट समवेयर वी डोंट फिट इन दैट पोस्चर एंड दैट काइंड ऑफ कैरेक्टर
अमित डोंट वरी द फर्स्ट प्रोडक्ट विल ऑलवेज बी सोल्ड ए कैटेगरी प्रोडक्ट इज ऑल्सो सोल्ड इन द मार्केट डोंट वरी एवरीबॉडी हैज हिज ओन स्पेस विद इन दैट
Everybody has his own path. I'll just tell you something very interesting on this, Amit, what you're saying. You see, when Virat Kohli came into the scene, Sachin Tendulkar was already a big player, but obviously he was on his way out. Virat came somewhere in 2010, if I remember correctly. And somebody seeing him playing said, Virat to ek din Tendulkar banega. You know what Virat said? He said, everybody wants to be Tendulkar, but I will be Virat Kohli one day. So, every person has a space for himself in this institution, in this profession. And I always feel, and I always say that as a senior, your growth is not as much as how well you have done in the profession. Your growth is as much as how people who have been associated with you have done in the profession. And the people have asked me so many things about God was kind. I got designated at the age of 40. God has been very kind to me in my profession. I have done cases in various courts, Supreme Courts, etc., arbitrations in India, abroad. But I always feel that the proudest moment I have in my profession is that I have about more than 125, 130 associates who have gone through my office. About 75, 80 of them are practicing advocates. Some have gone to the lower judiciary. Some have made law offices and they have joined big law offices or law firms, etc. But that's the proudest moment if I have to ever etch down that as a lawyer, what have I achieved? I would have said that people who have gone through my office and the people who are working in my office, I tried and I've always tried to make sure that they are as comfortable or almost as comfortable that as I can be.
Thank you, Mr. Bali. We are just wrapping it off. Before we sign off for today, in the evening session at 6 o'clock, we are having another session that should also be engrossing. That is fair disclosure in criminal prosecution. And in the session, we are having Purushendra Kaurav, who is a designated senior and advocate general of Madhya Pradesh. Along with him, we are having Tanveer Ahmed Mir, who is represented in the Talwar's case, Ayushi Talwar, Augusta Land, Indra Banerjee, Robert Vadera. So it should be an engrossing session. You can connect us on the Facebook page as well as Instagram page for more updates or our WhatsApp group. Vedika would formally give you a vote of thanks. It was a pleasure hearing you. I personally feel that large number of persons today who have heard them or once they hear it on the videos, they will have something which they will feel, yes, the difference between the ordinary and extraordinary, actually they have learned it today. Over to you, Vedika.
Thank you, Vikas, sir. It's a great honor and a personal privilege for me to give the vote of thanks today to Mr. Puneet Bali, Senior Advocate. Sir, like you had mentioned in the beginning of this session, that as young lawyers and law students, we should earmark one or two lawyers who we look up to and who we think have done well for themselves. So honestly, right from the beginning of my law school, in fact, even before that, when I decided to pursue law as a profession, I have been hearing your name a lot, and it's been on my agenda to personally hear you argue in court, to see how you present your case, to see how you conduct yourself before the judges. And I've been very lucky. In fact, all of us have been very lucky to have had the chance to see you argue and present cases on numerous occasions in the High Court as well as other courts. So coming to today's webinar, the topic itself, Law Kitchen, was something which intrigued all of us. And it was something which we were eagerly looking forward to because it did not seem like a routine topic. And I knew that there'll be a lot to gain from all your valuable tips and discussions. So thank you so much, sir, for giving us all the valuable tips that you have today. It's a great learning for each one of us, and you're a big inspiration for all of us. Thank you so much for taking out your valuable time for this session today. Thank you, sir.
Most welcome. And I'm really floored by what you said. And before I wind up, I will just tell to all my young friends who are in the profession that you people must dream to become the best. You must have faith in yourself that you have the ingredients to become the best. And whatsoever adverse circumstances you are pitted against in a day-to-day life in your profession, maybe you lose a good case, you lose a good client, please do not give up the fight in yourself. You never know when is Almighty going to be, you know, benevolent towards you. There have been people who are not first generation, who are first generation lawyers, who had no legal background, who have reached the pinnacles of this profession. So do not underestimate yourself that I don't have this, I don't have this start, I don't have this background. Each one of you, and I've seen the youngsters, I tell you, so much of knowledge, so much of zest they have, so much of spirit they have. I sometimes feel that they lack patience. They do not wait enough. They do not give themselves enough time to catch the ladder of success. But I assure you that each one of you have it in you one day you, any one of you, will become larger than what I am, larger than what the top Supreme Court lawyers. Have faith in yourself, have faith in your ability, and never ever lose heart.
Thank you, Mr. Puneet. From you, once we before sign up, so according to you, there are four P's: persistence, perseverance, and patience, and fourth would be Puneet. Thank you.
Thank you so much. God bless all of you. Stay safe, stay healthy. Bye-bye.
Thank you.